尊敬的各位嘉宾、合作伙伴、阿里云的开发者以及在终端前收看直播的朋友们，大家上午好！感谢大家来参加阿里云云栖大会杭州分会容器技术专场。我是本场的主持人般若，来自阿里云飞天八部。首先，感谢大家一直以来对云栖大会的关注与支持，希望能够和大家度过愉快的一天，让大家感到不虚此行。我相信大家应该有所感知，容器技术无疑是近年来最受人关注的一个方向。今天的论坛分为上午和下午两个部分，我们将为大家带来阿里巴巴集团容器技术的分享，分别来自国际容器技术的领袖 Docker、 CNCF、 Mrs. Few 嘉宾的分享，并有来自合作伙伴我们的客户会以亲身的经历来分享他们在容器技术运用过程中的方方面面。 OK， 那么接下来我们有请阿里巴巴集团资深技术专家毅力为我们带来敏捷开发预见未来的主题分享，有请毅力。
大家早上好，很高兴在这里看到这么多热爱容器技术的同学朋友还有我们的客户，非常感谢。这个会场不好找，能找这里的都是真爱，所以很开心。我第一个分享我今天的主题是敏捷进化预见未来。我今天主要会介绍三个部分。第一部分呢，就是会介绍阿里云上容器生态的成长。第二部分会介绍容器技术，我们的阿里云容器服务的一些最新进展和新特性。第三，我们会介绍一些基于容器的解决应用方案的创新。这里我们会介绍 ABC 三部分 AI、 Blockchain 区块链以及容器化 Containerization 这样几个解决方案。好，我相信来到这里的同学都对容器技术有了一定的了解。容器技术可以帮助企业实现更好的敏捷化。我们都知道，现在企业里无论传统企业还是互联网企业， IT 的能力都已经成为企业的核心竞争力。利用容器技术可以让整个的 IT 系统变得更加敏捷，变得更加可以适应纷繁变化的市场的变化和挑战。利用容器轻量级的虚拟化的技术，可以比传统的虚拟机的方案降低50%成本，并可以利用良好的这样的可移植性，实现应用从云下到云上的无缝迁移，而且可以灵活地构建这种混合云的方案，实现无边界的云计算。同时呢，容器技术也可以非常好的支撑和加速我们的 DevOps 流程，可以实现既快又稳的应用交付。和传统方法相比，它可以提升加速迭代速度是13倍，知道大家天下武功唯快不破。然后呢，加速的交付就意味着我们能以更快速度去创新，更低的成本去试错。容器技术可以支持传统的企业应用，也可以帮助用户逐渐的把传统企业应用重构成为微服务化的应用，每个服务都能独立部署、独立更新、独立伸缩。借助容器技术可以实现秒级的服务的伸缩和故障恢复。同时呢，企业的发展离不开新技术的创新。利用容器，我们可以有很多的分布式的解决方案，可以在分钟级实现应用的部署。OK， 抱歉，调试一下这个。OK， 好了，阿里云的容器服务在2016年5月正式商用，然后经历了1.5年的发展，我们已经在线上积累了近1000家企业客户，并且支撑了数千个容器集群。我们也不断地完善我们的技术和产品形态。在今年4月，我们推出了阿里云的飞天专有云敏捷版，它可以部署在用户自有的数据中心，可以部署在物理机或者虚拟机环境下。然后今年5月，我们推出了对 Kubernetes 的支持。今天 我们要介绍大家一些更多新的特性。OK， 对不起，好像这个不是，哦 ，OK。我们看看我们在阿里云容器服务上，我们的客户都在使用哪些容器技术，解决什么样的问题。我们列了几个主要的场景，它有相应的代表的客户，比如说千云，我们今天也邀请了 Flipboard 红板报，他从向大家分享从 AWS 向阿里云如何利用容器技术，在两个月以内就完成整个应用技术架构的迁移的过程。然后 DevOps 是实际上是使用容器技术所有的用户通用的一个解决方案，今天不过多介绍。让微服务，微服务和容器实际上相辅相成的，因为就是微服务带来很多运维的复杂度，而容器可以大大的简化微服务应用的 架构的部署和使用。今天我们也非常荣幸邀请了买单侠的首席架构师李驾来跟大家分享微服务架构的一些进展。另外呢，容器技术也支持着非常多的这样的业务创新，包括像马龙科技啊、FusionX， 他们都是利用容器技术来进行人工智能、大数据等等的业务创新。OK， 阿里云容器服务建立之初就致力于把容器技术跟阿里云能力结合在一起，并且把这能力回馈到开源社区，能够赋能更多的客户和合作伙伴在阿里云上构建他们自己的容器解决方案和应用。所以在2015年，就 OSS 对象存储就成为了 Docker 官方支持的镜像存储后端，然后我们也推出了阿里云的 Docker Machine 的驱动，可以已经集成在很多厂商的解决方案里头，比如像 Rancher，还有我们提供了阿里云日志服务的这样的插件，可以方便的帮助用户采集容器应用中的日志和进行管理。然后针对 Kubernetes， 我们也推出了阿里云相关的 Cloud Provider 的实现，提供了支持云盘的这样 Flex Volume 以及支持 VPC 的一个 Flannel 的一个网络驱动，给大家能够方便的让原生的 Kubernetes 就可以在阿里云上良好的支持。今天我们还有阿里集团和阿里云的更多的一些开源项目会跟大家进行分享。容器的成长离不开合作伙伴，阿里云和国际领先的容器技术初创公司和开源标准化组织都建立了非常好的关系。在去年的云栖大会上，我们宣布了和 Docker 的战略合作伙伴关系，然后呢，在今年6月份 Docker Hub 落地中国，可以更好地服务国内的开发者。然后在阿里云飞天专用云敏捷版中，我们也集成了 Docker 的企业版，可以为中国的企业客户提供一个稳定成熟的容器解决方案。今年5月，阿里云加入了 CNCF 云原生计算基金会，然后在这我们将致力于云原生计算相关的理念普及和基础设施的建设。今年8月 ，Mesosphere 也登陆阿里云云市场，可以方便地帮助阿里云的客户在云上部署他们的商业化的 DCOS 解决方案。我们还跟高校的进行了紧密合作，我们跟浙大的 SEL 实验室、跟华中科技大学都建立了良好的关系。我们跟这些的老师和同学一起在容器方面进行一些探索。今天下午，我们还会揭晓我们的合作伙伴项目。OK。下面我们就来到第二部分，介绍容器服务的一些最新进展。首先给大家介绍一下阿里云容器服务的一个概况。阿里云容器服务既有面向公共云的容器服务，也有可以部署在用户自有数据中心的飞天专用云敏捷版，在专用云环境下可以部署在物理机或者虚拟机上。我们同时支持 Kubernetes 和 Docker Swarm 集群。在 Docker Swarm 集群上，我们也同时支持 Linux 和 Windows 构成的混合集群。一些相关的特性我们后边会向大家重点介绍。容器服务在标准的 Kubernetes 和 Swarm 集群之上进行了更多的扩展，包括多集群管理能力，我们可以在一个控制面板同时管理 Kubernetes 集群和 Swarm。 然后呢， 我们可以用阿里云的账号或者用户自有的 LDAP 的用户账号来去对集群上的应用进行管理和授权，同时可以将公共云和专有云的容器集群打造成一个混合云集群，并且提供了完备的日志、监控、报警等运维能力。在应用层面，阿里云除了提供了容器镜像服务，另外呢，也提供了相应的一些容器化的解决方案，后边也会向大家介绍其中的一些内容。有了这样的一个容器的管理层之后，我们就可以支持不同类型的应用，包括像 DevOps 应用，既支持开源的这样的一些 DevOps 工具，我们也支持阿里云一些商业化的，比如像云校这样的一些 DevOps 的解决方案。同时我们支持像EDAS 这样的互联网中间件，也支持像 Davos Ring Cloud 这样的一些开源的微服务应用框架。容器技术其实除了支持微服务，也可以很好支持企业应用，可以很好的把 .NET App 还有像 WebSphere、 WebLogic 这些在企业里广泛使用的应用都转变化敏捷的企业应用。 OK， 阿里云一个很大的一个特点，容器技术就是将 Kubernetes 和 Docker 这样的容器技术和阿里云能力无缝的集成在一起，可以更好的利用优化的阿里云上的计算、存储、网络等能力。比如说在计算层面，不但可以利用阿里云上的虚拟机，也可以利用支持异构计算的这样的比如说 GPU 的机型。我们都在 Kubernetes 和 Docker 里边提供了针对 GPU 资源的调度能力，可以很好的支撑像深度学习等等的应用类型。在存储和网络方面，我们都是利用了 Docker 或者是 Kubernetes 自身的插件机制来对阿里云的块存储、对象存储和网络文件系统以及各种各样的网络类型来进行了良好的支撑，同时也集成了阿里云的日志服务、云监控以及像 RAM 这样的一些安全管理的一些工具，来简化整个的安全就是整个集群的管理和运维，同时也跟阿里云自身的 DevOps 工具进行了无缝的整合，比如像 Code Pipeline 和云校。阿里云上我们在十月份会推出对 Kubernetes 支持的升级，可以简单的在控制台上去创建出一个 Kubernetes 集群。我们都知道以前创建和维护一个高可用的 Kubernetes 集群是个并不容易的事情，但我们把这件事情简化成一个简单的一个选择，输入我需要多少个 master 节点、多少个 worker 节点，我可以在 worker 节点上选择 GPU 机型，我就可以得到一个支持异构计算的这样的一个 Kubernetes 集群。这里边已经集成了阿里云的存储网络等等的一些Cloud Provider 的一些能力，以及内置了高可用和安全。另外呢，我们能够在一个控制台面板上去管理 Kubernetes 集群和 Docker Swarm 集群，我们可以方便的选择相应的 Kubernetes 集群，并用阿里云的账号对它进行授权管理，然后去访问它的 dashboard。 OK， 除了在 Kubernetes 上进展，我们也继续在 Docker Swarm 上去拓展它的能力，因为现在企业里边除了像我们的 Linux、 我们的这样 Java 这样的一些应用被广泛使用，还有大量企业使用像 .NET Application， 而现在 Docker Swarm 是一个最成熟的能够支持这种混合集群管理的一个技术解决方案。借助于 Docker 1706版本提供能力，我们可以很好的支持 Windows 和 Linux 混合集群，我们可以把我们的 .NET 和 MS SQL Server 这样的应用部署在 Windows 节点，然后把 MySQL Redis 这样的一些 server 部署在我们的 Linux 的 worker 节点上。随着企业对容器使用的一个进一步的一个深入，大家对运维能力的要求也逐渐提升，然后在一个集群上如何更好支持多租户，实际上是一个很多用户的普遍需求。我们提供了灵活的资源配额的管理的能力，比如说我们可以把一个集群拆分成不同的资源池，我们在节点上可以通过 label 把一个集群，比如说在这个事例里头，我们把它拆分成两个资源池，一个是开发的一个资源池，一个是测试的资源池。然后呢，我们分别把它分配给开发团队和测试团队。由于这些节点，它之间不会，就是开发的应用不会去影响到测试的应用，这样的话形成了一个很好的一个隔离。我们进一步在上面增加了一个细粒度的资源配额的管理，我们可以限定一个用户或一个组它能使用的最多的 CPU 和 memory 资源，这样的话就会防止由于一个应用的误配置，然后侵占了大量资源，导致了影响其他人的应用。在十月份我们会宣布容器镜像服务的正式商业化，其实这个服务已经上线两年了，然后已经支持了数万的国内的开发者。然后呢，大家对这个应该不陌生。我们现在的容器镜像服务已经不但对外对阿里云上的客户服务，也在对内支撑着我们整个双十一的容器化应用发布的这样的整个的应用平台。现在对内对外已经超过了将近十万个 image 的 repo， 然后已经超过了2亿次的下载。容器镜像服务可以，它作为整个容器化 DevOps 解决方案的一个核心，可以方便的和持续集成和持续交付都结合在一起，可以跟开源的像 Jenkins 啊、云效这样的方案结合在一起，实现代码到镜像，然后也可以无缝的发布到容器服务，然后利用蓝绿啊，然后不间断发布等，然后实现非常稳定的这样的应用交付方式。同时我们也增加了安全扫描能力，然后用户也可以在云市场上去选择和购买容器化的镜像，然后一键部署在阿里云上。 OK， 介绍完容器产品的一些新特性，我们下面来看容器的应用解决方案。我们知道这几年深度学习人工智能是一个非常火爆的话题，因为在这里除了算法的进展、数据的积累，更重要的是计算能力的一个爆发。相比传统的以 CPU 的计算方式， GPU、 FPGA 等异构计算方式更加适合深度学习等等的一些计算需求。比如拿分布式模型训练为例，使用 GPU 它的效能会比使用传统的 CPU 的效率提升25倍。然后呢，阿里云的容器服务可以良好的支撑各种各样的一些主流的深度学习和高性能计算框架，比如像 TensorFlow、 像 MXNet 以及像 MPI、 Slurm 这样的一些不同的一些框架，可以把阿里云上提供的强大的异构计算能力快速的转变成价值。我们知道在阿里云最新发布的 GN5 系列GPU 机型里边，我们支持单机8卡 P100 的 NVIDIA 的这样的一个设备，它有强大计算力。我们在 Docker Swarm 和 Kubernetes 上都提供了对 GPU 资源的调度的支持，可以方便的让用户去构建这样的深度学习的解决方案。根据用户的常见需求，基于阿里云的容器服务，我们推出了面向深度学习的解决方案，覆盖了从模型的开发、训练到预测整个生命周期。在这个过程中，它可以极大的简化分布式深度学习应用的部署的复杂度，拿一个部署一个分布式的 TensorFlow 的 training 的这样的一个应用而言，传统方式需要你配置 NVIDIA driver 啊，安装 Docker 啊，做很多很多的配置，然后这个时间可能需要2天，但是我们可以把这时间缩短到5分钟。另外呢，除此之外，我们也提供了对 GPU 资源的监控、预警和弹性伸缩能力，可以让您的机学应用按需的扩展。我们也把云端大规模的部署实践内置到我们解决方案之中，我们提供了优化的网络配置，把使用云端存储，比如说保存像 checkpoint file 啊，一些日志文件的一些优化都内置到这个解决方案里边， 可以支持庞大的一个计算机群，最大的一个 GPU 机群我们当时超过了几百台。下面我们将跟大家做一个演示，这个演示呢就是基于容器上部署的一个视频风格迁移的一个应用，将动态捕捉的视频根据一个世界名画的风格渲染成相应的一个油画风格。好，请播放视频。我们可以看到这个集群里有两个节点，这里头有相应的 GPU 节点，我们可以看到上面的 GPU 的设备，我们可以非常简单的选择一个模型预测的一个解决方案，然后输入它的应用名称，选择相应的镜像，以及就是说使用多少个 GPU 资源，它的存储和一些 load balancer 的配置，点击确定，我们的一个视频风格迁移的应用就已经部署好了。根据相应的 load balancer 的网址，我们可以在本地启动一个视频捕捉的一个应用，它会动态的捕捉人脸，并且把相应的图片动态转换成相应的风格，非常简单，对不对？大家都可以，每个人都可以试一下，只用花一杯咖啡的钱。然后呢，我们可以看到在 Grafana 上大家可以配置相应的 GPU 的一些使用情况，包括 GPU 的利用率、显存利用率、温度等等情况，这样的话可以给你有一个很好的一个支持，这样弹性伸缩的一个支持。好，感谢。区块链，我相信很多人也听到过这个技术 blockchain， 它是一种共享的分布式账本技术，基于像分布式共识、智能合约等等一些底层技术，实现了在缺乏信任的环境下进行交易的这种可能性。然后它现在也是一个非常火热的技术，因为它在引领从传统的信息互联网转向价值互联网的一个这样的一个转变。在这个过程中，很多企业已经开始尝试用区块链技术来去构建一些创新应用，比如说像资产管理、物流航运以及食品安全溯源等等。然后呢，今天我们会介绍我们基于 Hyperledger Fabric 的一个区块链解决方案。 Hyperledger 超级账本是 Linux 基金会旗下一个开源的面向商用的一个区块链的合作项目，其中 Hyperledger Fabric是一个非常流行的区块链开发框架，然后它的整个的开发和部署其实都是基于容器化的，而且像智能合约这样的一些代码也是以容器的方式运行在区块链网络之上。我们已经支持了很多客户来去在阿里云上构建它的区块链的解决方案，为了简化区块链的这样的开发测试，然后呢推进然后区块链技术的普及，我们把我们积累的技术沉淀转化成相应的区块链解决方案。我们都知道区块链的在本地部署，如果大家试一下，在本地部署实际上蛮简单，拿 Docker Compose 文件就可以一下创建一个本地的开发环境，但是部署一个生产环境，解决不同节点之间的安全通信、水平扩展、高可用却并非易事，而且要调整区块链的拓扑结构，里边涉及到大量配置的一个变更，非常复杂，而且容易出错，即使熟练的开发人员可能还需要一天的时间来完成。但是呢，我们提供了一个简单定制向导，用户可以输入一些最基本参数，多少个 peer、 多少个 organization、 多少个 order， 就可以动态的一键创建相应的区块链的方案，然后将这个部署时间缩短到5分钟。下面我会跟大家演示一个 demo， 去如何一键去创建一个 Hyperledger Fabric 1.0 的一个框架，然后并进行一个本地的一个测试，同时我们再以 Hyperledger Explorer 然后检查上面的执行结果。好，先播放视频，谢谢。我们在解决方案页面，然后选择创建，我们就可以看到一个整个区块链的一个配置，大家可以简单的选择确定，就可以把一个复杂的分布式区块链部署在阿里云上，它背后已经有超过30个容器服务已经启动起来。几分钟之后，我们就可以看到，当它就绪之后，我们可以通过 他自身的一个路由地址，然后获取他相关的一些访问信息，然后我们可以在本地运行一个转账的一个简单的一个测试应用，来去验证它功能的正确。 OK， 看着执行结果是正确了，那我们去打开 Hyperledger Explorer， 我们可以清楚地看到在区块链上所串联的区块以及相关的交易的信息，可以非常方便地帮助大家快速地验证和开发我们属于我们自己的区块链的创新应用。好，谢谢。OK， 下面我将介绍一个容器迁移的工具。我们接触过很多客户，尤其是刚入手的客户，大家经常的一个问题就是说，容器技术很好，但是我不知道该怎么做。我不知道怎么把我现在的一个应用转变成一个容器化的应用。而且我们在接触过很多客户之后，也发现其实即使已经使用容器的客户，由于不了解容器技术自身的一些最佳实践 DevOps 的一些最佳实践，走了很多弯路。为此呢，我们把我们在支持客户的过程中沉淀下来的一些能力变成了一个工具，一个简单的一个工具，叫做 Derek。 今天我们把它也开源到 GitHub 上。Derek 的一个意思其实是起重机，它可以方便的把应用装箱然后放到云上，所以说这样的一个简单的工具，它可以让开发人员专注于应用自身，而不是那些容器化的一些细节。它可以创建出很多的脚手架的代码，帮助你去简化学习容器的技术门槛。它有哪些功能呢？一个是它基于代码的检测技术，然后能够自动的生成相应的 Dockerfile。它支持像 Node.js、Spring Boot， 还有像 Python 等等常见的一些编程的框架，它会动态的生成相应的 Dockerfile、Docker-compose file， 可以帮助你可以在本地的进行开发和测试。以及呢，我们也可以生成像 JSON file， 一键去实现相应的 DevOps 流程。在这个过程中，我们内建了容器化的一些最佳实践，比如通过 Multi-Stage Build， 就是多阶段构建，可以生成更加小、更加安全的这样的容器化的镜像。为了给大家有一个更加形象的一个理解，我们先做一个演示。它会利用 Derek 的一个本地命令，一键实现一个 Node.js 的一个容器化，并且我们可以快速地把它发布到一个 Jenkins 的 code pipeline 之上，同时我们可以调整整个的发布流程，然后让它一键上云。OK， 请播放视频。现在是一个 Node.js 的一个本地的一个 workspace， 我们用 Derek init 就可以完成对整个 workspace 的 inspection， 然后呢创建相应的一些文件，比如相应的 Jenkins 的 pipeline， 相应 Docker compose file， 然后支持了多阶段构建的一个 Docker file。 大家不用了解太多细节就可以开始进行一些测试。我们用Derek upgen 命令就可以完成镜像的构建以及启动一个 Docker compose 的一个模板，我们就可以访问这样的一个应用。访问应用之后，我们可以把它推送到 GitHub 上，然后呢它会触发相应的，如果我们在上面配置了一个 Jenkins 的pipeline as a code， 我们就可以看到它生成的 Jenkins file 就可以生成这样的 CI 的流水线。它可以利用NPM 进行构建， mock 进行对 Node.js 进行测试，以及check style 就 code style 进行那个 code quality 的检查。我们现在可以把它再增加一步，我们希望它部署到云上。我们可以选择容器服务自身的一个访问地址，然后配置相应的部署的步骤，然后点击确认之后，最后我们会增加了一个 deployment 步骤。deployment 步骤之后就会把它发布到云上，发布的云通过生成的 compose 文件之中的一个路由的一个 label， 我们就可以在公共云上进行访问。这样的工作去省略了很多大家探索和试验的一些时间，可以让大家更加的专注，降低了我们的学习成本。 OK， 这是我的最后一个 slide， 就是说 阿里云的容器服务提供了和云能力的无缝集成，然后经过了大规模生产的一些验证，支撑了我们上千家的近千家的一些企业客户。另外呢，我们是完全秉承着开放兼容的一些理念，完全支持原生的 Kubernetes、 Docker Swarm 等等集群技术，也去更好的去支持企业所需像 Linux、 Windows 等多种操作系统。 OK， 好，感谢大家的时间。好，谢谢。我们可以有两个问题，然后呢，这是
感谢毅力的精彩分享。我们接下来有一个提问的一个环节，然后我们会送出我们阿里云的一些文化衫的一些 T 恤，然后送给那些开放那个提问的同学们。有没有哪位同学想？你好。
你好。
就是刚才那个演讲嘉宾提到，就是那个在那个阿里云上支持部署那个深度学习的应用，包括区块链这一些。
是的。
那这些是在专有云上也提供类似的服务吗？
是的，
就是敏捷版上。
对，就是这样的，就是阿里云的容器服务有不同的产品形态，有面向公共云的服务和专有云的服务，然后但是它是同一套代码，同一套架构，然后所以说它既会出现在我们的公共云服务上，也会出现在我们的专有云的云产品飞天专有云敏捷版上。
好的，就是那个因为专有云跟那个公有云其实还是有一些差异的，是吧？
是的，
但就是说
这
些
主要是时间的一个问题，因为比如说公共云可能会先发布一些时间，然后呢我们专有云实际上是有一个自己的迭代周期，只有这样的一个差异，没有其他的差异。
就是刚才那两块都有的是吧？
对，是的。
好，谢谢。
好。好，那位。
不好意思，我问一个问题，就是那个Kubernetes 的 load balance。
OK。
那个阿里云的 ICE 这层服务有没有加入到那个它的上游计划的上游厂商的计划的这个当中呢？
Okay。 这是个很好的问题啊，就是我们已经把相关的阿里云的 cloud provider提供出来的，而且它是个 out of tree 的一个 cloud controller， 所以说呢你可以非常方便的去利用阿里云的 SLB 来去和您自己的 Kubernetes 集群部署在一起。就是如果您感兴趣可以回到就是我们的 GitHub 上的一个 URL， 我不知道是
那个我用过，我知道，我清楚。
okay,
我清楚，我就是问有没有加入到 Kubernetes 本身的上游
产品。因为是这样的，就 Kubernetes 它有自己的社区的一个规则，它现在不再接受其他的 intra 的这样的一个cloud provider 的一个 controller， 它是现在是建议采用 out of tree 的方式，就是不在 Kubernetes 自身的 repo 里 去维护，因为这样的话可以让云供应商的这个能力和 Kubernetes 核心代码进行解耦，它这样的话可以独立的发展和独立的迭代，这样的话其实可以更好的适配像现在这个能力。现在在 Kubernetes 1.7 里边现在是 beta， 正式的 release 会在 1.9， 但是现在我们使用是没有问题的，我们也在跟像浙大的一些老师同学一块推进，把相关的一些规范尽快的成熟化。
明白，我那个使用是没问题的，因为我也用的这个服务。
好，谢谢啊。还有吗？不好意思，因为就是后边还有很多重量级的演讲嘉宾，所以呢，大家有问题的话，我就在后边，大家可以去跟我和我团队进行交流。好，谢谢。
对，在场的朋友们，就是还有问题的话。欢迎会后继续和容器团队的同学提问。2017年，容器技术已经被越来越多的企业所接受，并且构建了丰富的容器生态。 CNCF 基金会对容器生态做了大量的贡献，推出了丰富的开源项目，包括 Containerd、 CNI、 Kubernetes。 下面有请 CNCF 执行总裁 Dan 分享如何将传统 IT 架构转型为基于云原生的微服务架构。有请 Dan。
谢谢。 Thank you very much。 你好。 My name is Dan Kahn。I am the executive director of the cloud native Computing Foundation, and I'm thrilled to be here in Hangzhou at the Alibaba Cloud Conference. I just flew in yesterday from New York City in order to be here, and so I'm very excited. I would like to walk you through a little bit about the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, what we're doing with our projects like Kubernetes and Prometheus and Containerd, and then also take you through what I call a brief history of the cloud. But first, for my foundation, we are a little bit less than 2 years old. So it's very new, but we're part of the Linux Foundation, which is 17 years old now. And we now have 12 projects in the foundation. We started with Kubernetes, which was contributed by Google about a year and a half ago, and we've been adding a new project every month or two. And on the bottom row here, you can see the 20 companies that are our platinum members and the main backers. We're also thrilled to have a very significant support from Alibaba. They're a gold member and have been instrumental in us moving forward, especially in China. So most people know the Linux Foundation for Linux, and we do employ Linus Torvalds and the stable kernel maintainer, Greg Crowe Hartman. In fact, we brought both of them to China for the first time a few months ago in June. We had our first conference in Beijing that was very exciting. But what's interesting is that the Linux Foundation is now doing far more than just Linux. So you may be familiar with Let's Encrypt, which provides free TLS certificates to now a majority of the internet, cause it's the biggest certificate authority, completely for free. In networking, we have a project called ONAP, which combines together technology from China Mobile, the OpenO project, with technology from AT&T, called Ecomp, and is now providing a software-defined networking solution that's going to be used by more than half the mobile subscribers around the world. On the cloud, we have CNCF, and that's what my talk today is about. In automotive, every new Toyota Camry is now using Linux inside of its automotive system, and that's going to be going in many, many more cars over the next few years. Our previous speaker just mentioned Hyperledger on the blockchain, where Alibaba has been a leader, and we've been very happy to have their support. And then you're probably familiar with Node.js is one of the most exciting new application frameworks. So all of these technologies are part of the Linux Foundation. The Linux Foundation is now really a foundation of what projects on the internet. So which projects have the most developers, are making the most changes, the largest community. And what makes it a strange chart is that it's a log chart. So down at the bottom, this is the number of commits on the x-axis, and on the y-axis is the number of pull requests and issues. And what you can see at the very top is the Linux kernel remains the highest velocity project in the history of open source. And interestingly, Chromium, that's the open source version of Chrome, is very close to it. But I want to point out in green here, Kubernetes is, depending on how you count, the third or fourth highest velocity project in pink, right in the middle, because my colleagues, Patrick, are going to be speaking from Docker right after me. And so this has been a neat project, and you can see on the URL there the information. But all of this is based on it's all open source if you wanted to learn more about it. But what you can communities, fastest moving communities in the history of open source. Okay. And now I have one more chart that is very difficult to read, but let me just emphasize the URL right here, .com/CNCF/landscape. can get a high resolution of this, version of this. But this is trying to give a view of, and what it's saying is that there are over open source projects. Thank you very much. Sorry about that. There are over 300 different open source projects and companies that are providing these technologies. So at the bottom, you can see Alibaba Cloud is one of the five biggest cloud companies in the world. And across the different areas, what we find is as enterprises roll out cloud-native technologies, they often need to pick one project or one vendor to work with in each of these boxes. And so what this diagram is trying to do is to build a map and say, here are all of the options, and then the ones in dark blue are CNCF projects. So we're not saying that we're the only one to choose, but we're saying that our projects are sure to work well together. They're all open source, but they're backed by a number of different companies. They're a very safe, reliable path to the cloud-native future. Okay, so now let me give you what I call a brief history of the cloud. And the idea here is this is very opinionated. This is my particular history. But it is trying to go through the progression over time. So we start back in 2000 with Sun Microsystems. And at this moment, in 2000, I was a venture capitalist in Silicon Valley, and companies would come to me and say, I have the idea for a website that I want to build. It wasn't apps yet. And they would say, I need $2 million or $3 million in order to buy enough hardware, so if my website is successful, I can meet the demand. And essentially, they would go spend almost all of that money with Sun. And so Sun's was very, very successful. But the key thought is that the application building block, when an entrepreneur or an engineer was thinking about an application, was a physical server. But the secret of this is that a ton of those applications were not using all the capacity of the server. In fact, there's a lot of calculations saying that many applications were only using 3% or 5% of the server's capability. So now we jump to 2001 with a VMware. And in each of these cases, this was not necessarily the company that invented virtualization, but it was the company that popularized it and really profited the most from it. And VMware built a software solution to wrap your application, and now you could put many different applications all on the same server. They would think that they each had their own server. And so the application building block that the engineer would focus on was no longer the server or a rack of servers, it was VMs. And as a result, VMware made billions and billions of dollars and was incredibly successful. And arguably, virtualization was the most important computing technology of the previous decade. So now we fast forward to 2006, when Amazon Web Services popularized the concept of infrastructure as a service, or IaaS. And this was this magical moment where they took what had previously been CapEx, the entrepreneur needing a couple million dollars in order to build out the infrastructure, and changed it to be OpEx, an operating expense where they could bill by the hour for those servers. And more recently, they changed it to billing by the minute. And in fact, this month, they now offer per second billing. It doesn't make that much difference, but it's just an amazing thing that you now just spend for the capacity that you're actually using. The application building block they called an Amazon machine image, an AMI, but it was still basically the same thing as a virtual machine. The building block from the engineer's perspective didn't really change any. And now we fast forward to 2009, and you had this company, Heroku, that was extremely successful in Silicon Valley. And for a lot of people, like myself, really introduced us to the idea of DevOps. And so you're an engineer, you're working on an application, someone comes over and says, oh, there's a bug here, when I click this, it doesn't work right. Maybe it only takes you one or two lines of code in order to fix it. you get it working on your own developer machine, and then you type this magic phrase, git push Heroku, and about 30 seconds later, the new version of your application is live on the website. And so to see that kind of progress and be able to get to the position of making dozens of deployments per day instead of what many companies had is a new version once a quarter or a new version maybe once a month, it just totally changed what we call the development velocity around software. And so the building block that they had, they called a build pack. It basically was a container. It's an opaque container, meaning you can't really know what's going on inside. There's a lot of sort of magic that is hiding from you. But if you were using one of their approved languages, Ruby on Rails or Node.js, and they added others over time, it really gave you just an amazing experience. But the thing that I want to emphasize on now on those first four steps in the history is that all of those were closed source proprietary companies. They all made a lot of money, but now the next four steps along our journey are all open source. And so in 2010, you had OpenStack form, originally by Rackspace and NASA. And in a lot of ways, you can see OpenStack as being designed to compete with Amazon Web Services, providing IaaS, and with VMware, providing a good way to run VMs. And it took longer than they thought it would in order to really have the software running reliably, but it works very well today. There's deployments all around the world. There's a lot of people that are very happy with it. And it was successful at bringing together a whole group of vendors to offer a competitor to an open source competitor to those products. Then in 2011, Cloud Foundry was launched, and this was really an open source alternative to Heroku. So Heroku invented and popularized the concept of a 12-factor application, and you can think of this as a set of guidelines, a set of rules or guardrails that if you follow them, it makes it very easy to build your application, to deploy it, and to scale it out in order to meet demand. And so it's things like parity, having your development and your production environment be the same, defining all of the state and environment variables, treating logs as a stream instead of a file. And Cloud Foundry took all of those ideas from Heroku, but said, no, you don't have to just run them on Heroku's proprietary system. Here's an open source implementation that you can run on your own hardware or on a public cloud like Alibaba or anywhere else. And again, it took a little bit longer, I think, for that to get fully mature. It launched in 2011 and became open source in 2014. But there's now a number of different companies that are very happy with Cloud Foundry. This is also another foundation within the Linux Foundation. Okay, and now I'll come to 2013, which is probably the biggest surprise in the story. It was this company, Docker. And what's interesting about Docker is they took three technologies, this guy Solomon Hikes, that were already available. LXC had been added to the kernel and by Google, Union File Systems by some academics, C Groups had been added several years before. And I draw the analogy to the World Wide Web in 1990 with Tim Berners-Lee. When you go back and you look at, well, what was the web? What was special about it? There's really three parts. He took HTTP, which is just a slightly better version than FTP. And he took HTML, which is just a simplified version of an already existing markup language called SGML. And then he invented this concept of URLs, but there's nothing that special about it. It's just an address, a standard way of writing addresses that you can access any resource. But sometimes when you take pre-existing technologies and combine them together with a really easy-to-use interface, magic happens. And I think that was the case with the World Wide Web. And I think it really the same thing with Docker, where these three technologies allowed you to wrap an application in a way that it became immutable, repeatable. And so Docker solved this age-old question of your software development team, you have a new member get hired, and she sits down at her computer the first day, and she's given a long list of instructions of how to set up her computer in order to have the development environment running, in order to be able to start coding. And she goes through 4 or 5 hours of following commands and installing software and doing the steps, and then she comes to an error, and she goes to one of the existing people, sometimes somebody with a beard, and says, I got this error, and hears back, oh, well, it works for me. I don't know what your problem is. And so the magic of Docker is that in development, when you have a working container, a working installation and system, you can exactly copy that and give it to everybody else on the team, even if they're using Mac or Windows or Linux, and they can be guaranteed to have exactly the same environment that you totally avoid that works for me problem. And finally, that brings us to CNCF and to Kubernetes. And so the idea here is that we describe cloud native as having three main components, that you divide your application up into lots of different pieces that are called microservices. You wrap every one of those microservices in its own Docker container, and then you use an orchestration platform like Kubernetes in order to have all of those pieces work together. So let's now review that kind of quick history. And just look at what were the trends over that time. So we started out with Sun, where the application building block was a piece of physical hardware. And then it moved to a virtual machine, and then to build packs, which are kind of opaque container, and then to containers, like Docker containers. And so during that time, the spin-up time, it's gone from heavyweight to lighter weight. The spin-up time has gone from weeks, which is what it took to order a new server and have it delivered and installed, to seconds for virtual machines, to 100 milliseconds or less for a lot of container environments. And then there's this concept of going from pets to cattle, where it used to be that every server was custom configured and you never quite knew what state it was. Instead, with cattle, you treat all the servers as the same and process them in bulk. And then finally, the provider went from a single company, closed source proprietary, to being able to have multiple companies open source that you can choose between them. So the one other detail that I'll just give in that is people say, well, what about PaaS? PaaS, this 12-factor platform as a service, was really popular. Does that mean it's going away? And the answer is no. There's still a ton of value to 12-factor. It's a very good pattern for developing some of or even many of your applications. But 12-factor is like a set of guardrails that it's nice to be able to start there. Sometimes your application outgrows that, and you need to come up with, you need to be able to store state, you need to be able to provide other things. And so our message is that we think you should be building PaaS on top of Kubernetes and similar orchestrators, not as a alternative to it. Okay, so let's now go through and say, why are people excited about cloud native? What are the benefits that this evolution has actually brought? And so the first one is the ability to avoid lock-in. That with open source, if you want to work with a company like Alibaba, they're very happy to support you. They can provide technical support and do that. But if you want to, you can also download the software yourself from the internet, see exactly how it works. If you find bugs, you can improve them. You're not locked into a single vendor. The next one is scalability. So there's a statistic from Google that they start up 2 billion containers per week. That's 3,300 per second on average, but in fact, at peak times, their number is far, far higher than that. And so the idea is that these containerization, these orchestration systems are designed to scale to really any imaginable level that you can have an Alipay kind of application that, that you can support with it. The next one is agility. And so this is my slide for microservices. And I'll give a little shout out to these pirates who had to work unbelievably hard to get the containers into these boats. But the idea is that you separate out your application into different pieces. You explicitly define how each of the different microservices work with each other, how they rely on each other, and all of that is implemented in software, in code, that you can version control and evolve over time. The next piece is orchestration. And so the idea of having a central orchestration layer that can keep track of all of these dependencies, can automatically scale to meet demand, and of course has high availability itself, so that if any given server or piece dies, the orchestration continues working normally. And then the next one is resiliency, which is that individual containers are going to fail, servers, even entire data centers, and that you can design and build a system that can automatically deal with that, that also can deal with the resiliency of demand, that when you have a flash sale, a large number of new users, that you can automatically scale up to deal with that. So that is the kind of basic idea of CNCF and cloud native, and why we're excited about this space, why we think there's a ton of opportunity. We are going to be holding our biggest event of the year in Austin, Texas on December 6th through 8th, and would love, we're actually going to be having a lot of attendees and a number of speakers from China. We would love for you to consider attending. We think it's really a fantastic opportunity to learn more about this space. And then in May 2nd through 4th, we're going to be in Copenhagen, Denmark, and holding that event again, and which should be just as large, and a number of other exciting opportunities. So we would love to have many of you consider attending. And finally, I will just include my email, and also this presentation is available at this URL. That if you have questions or you want to share it, I'm actually, it may take me another day, but I'll be uploading the Chinese version of it as well. And I would encourage you to please reach out to me with any questions. CNCF is dramatically expanding our membership in China. We have local representatives here in Hong Kong, and we're very eager to work with partners in China, especially end users and providers like Alibaba. So let me end there. I'm happy to take a minute and answer some questions. Let me just put my my earpiece in so I can understand them. But thank you all very much.
Thank you, Dan 的分享。然后我们接下来有一些提问的一些时间。有没有想提问的一些朋友？对，我们现场有同声传译。
Thank you,
Dan. 容器技术加速了企业的业务迭代和创新，如何快速的落地容器技术是一个值得思考的问题。在一个新的业务中使用容器技术全新搭建应用相对来说比较简单，但是如何快速地将已有的应用做容器化的改造却是一个难题。下面有请来自 Docker 公司的首席布道师讲述如何利用容器技术把传统应用现代化改造的过程自动化，以及如何顺畅地建立云原生微服务的架构应用。有请来自 Docker 公司的 Patrick。
Thank you. Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Patrick Chenezon, and I work at Docker. And today we're going to talk about what I call the Docker way, the Docker DAO. I'm a big fan of Lao Tzu, and you'll see I have a few metaphors around Taoism and the way that Docker works and the philosophy behind Docker. So first, a little bit about myself. I really loved Dan's presentation before because when he shows his history of cloud computing, basically that's my career. So I started at Netscape, and then I was at Sun in 2000. Then I moved to Google, and I have just one fix in his history of cloud computing. The concept of platform as a service was actually invented at Google with Google App Engine, but Heroku, I agree, was more successful. Then after that, I moved to VMware for Cloud Foundry, that open source platform as a service that Dan talked about, to evangelize that and create the evangelism team around Spring and Cloud Foundry. Then I moved to Microsoft for Azure on the .NET side, but also Java and Linux. And very quickly, at the end of my tenure at Microsoft, I specialized in that new technology that just came out that Solomon Hikes created in 2013 that was called Docker. And I just realized that a lot of our customers at Microsoft were using Docker to containerize applications and move them to Azure. So naturally, at Microsoft, it was a great way to bring some workloads to Azure. And so I started to focus on that and get specialized. And then I met Solomon, and I decided to join Docker. So I've been at Docker for 2 years. Another thing, this is my daughter, Charlotte, and she says, ni hao. She's learning Mandarin, and So she's learning Mandarin, and she taught me how to pronounce that. Hopefully, I didn't get it wrong. So she says hi. And another thing I wanted to mention is, so as I said, I joined Docker 2 years ago. The reason I joined is when I started playing with Docker, I had exactly the same feeling I had 20 years before when I used the Netscape browser for the first time. So back in the days, 20 years ago, I was a client-server developer at Accenture. And so I was building client-server applications on Windows with a backend with an Oracle database. And it was a pretty painful process to develop these. And when I tried the browser for the first time, I realized, hey, if we put a server on the other side that serves the HTML, we could build all our apps this way. And that's how the concept of web apps took over. And I found that a very elegant and profound way in which we could build applications differently. When I played with Docker a few years ago, I had exactly the same feeling. This is the kind of tool that will really change the way we're building applications. And so I really wanted to be part of that adventure. And that's why I joined 2 years ago. Before we talk about the Docker philosophy, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the trends that I've seen in the industry in the past few years. The first one is Agile, and Dan talked about that as well. The way to summarize it the best, and especially for business people, not only for Agile, is not only about developers, it's also about the business value that they create. The best way it has been summarized is by Adrian Cockcroft when he was at Netflix. Today he's at AWS. And he summarized it by optimizing what he calls the MTBMSH. It's a fun acronym, but the meaning behind it is very real. So it's about minimizing the mean time between having an idea and making stuff happen. So you have an idea, you start coding, and your code runs in production. There's a whole process that goes into that, and that process is the Agile process. In Mark's talk this morning, he showed the whole chain from when you're pushing some code back to where it's in production. These tools help you do that. Agile was kind of the methodology that was introduced by Ken Beck in the name of XP in 99. I remember trying to introduce that in my team at Sun in 2000. It evolved into these Agile methodologies, and today everybody adopted that. I think it's a well understood fact. A second trend that's more recent, that's 5 years old, is called DevOps. And DevOps is another of these cultural movements, a real shift in the way people are working. And it's not only about tools, it's about people, processes, and tools. And so it's not only about the tools, people and processes are very important for DevOps. And DevOps is essentially devs and ops used to fight each other, and devs would develop the application, push the code on the other side, and let the ops manage it. And when cloud computing started to grow with Amazon initially in 2006, in these companies like Amazon and Google, the teams who were creating the software were also the teams operating it. It's the famous Jeff Bezos memo about the two pizza teams where teams should work on a small bounded service, create the code for it, and operate it as well. And so that gave birth to that DevOps movement where devs and ops are working closely together, are using the same tools and the same processes, and are collaborating using a set of practices like continuous delivery that Mark demoed earlier today, infrastructure as code. So the IaaS platforms that Dan talked about enable that, having infrastructure checked in as code in your GitHub repository or in your source code control repository. Cross-silo collaboration is very important, having lots of small iterations, and having that feedback loop between development and operations so that you can learn from what happens in production in your application. You do things like A-B testing, and then this informs how you're making your application evolve. So DevOps is a very important trend, and actually one of the reasons of the success of Docker is that it appeared at the moment when DevOps started to take off, and it was really the tool of choice for DevOps practitioners. But the people and process aspect is very important too. This is a number that shows why DevOps is important from a business standpoint, not only from a technical one. In 1999, the number of servers managed by one sysadmin in the Windows world that was not very automated, where people were spending lots of time clicking on dialog boxes, was five. So one sysadmin would manage five machines. In the Linux world, which was more automated, it was around 50. In 2015, in large organizations like Google, Facebook, who are very automated, are using containers, the ratio is one sysadmin for 10,000 to 20,000 machines. And this is true for Linux and Windows. In the Azure team, they are managing hundreds of thousands of machines with Windows. It's all automated. And the factor here is a factor of 2,000. And in order to get these economies of scale, you need to standardize your infrastructure to treat machines as cattle and not as pets, as Dan said before. And also to create a containerization platform on top of that in order to manage all that. One thing I wanted to remind you is DevOps is not only about tools, it's also about people and processes. And Hank Kolk, who's the CIO at ING, gave an excellent talk at DockerCon touching not only about the way they're using Docker to do DevOps at ING, but also about how they reorganized the whole company, hired different type of people, and really changed the way they were operating the company in order to adopt DevOps. So that talk is really interesting. It's from 2014 at DockerCon Europe, and you can find the video there. And the last trend, Dan talked about that, so I'll go quickly on that, is microservices. So in year 2000, when I was working at Sun, the game at that time was really vertical scalability. You buy a big sandbox, you put your Java application that's vertically scalable on top of that, and then you're talking to an Oracle database that runs on another E10,000 big expensive sandbox. That was the way we were building applications back in 2000. It was the same in the .NET world, but there it was like big Windows machines. What happened is essentially Google. When Larry and Sergey created Google, instead of going to buy a big sandbox, they went to Fry's, which is an electronics shop in Silicon Valley, and they bought hard drive computer boards and CPUs, and they assembled their own supercomputer based on all these different parts. And that computer was a lot of small computers together with an algorithm on top that would just expose it as a supercomputer. And so they started that trend of going from vertical scalability with very expensive sandboxes to horizontal scalability, where you have lots of very small boxes that run microservices and that are horizontally scalable. And then the whole industry followed after that. If you're interested in that, I highly recommend you to read Larry and Sergey's original paper from 1999. You can find it on, in PDF, and it's a very interesting read. You see the original architecture they had for the search engine that was distributed from day one. So that trend to microservice now like took over the whole industry. Not only like the big web giants are using it, most of the new applications that are built in companies are now built with microservices in mind. But in order to do that, you need to adopt new tools, and you need to design your application in a slightly different way. So now let's talk about the Docker platform. So at Docker, we're building tools of mass innovation. What we mean by that is that we take some technology that is obscure or difficult to use, and we make it easy to use, and we democratize it. And that's what Solomon did. As Dan explained, he took LXC and Union File Systems and C groups, put them together into that Docker workflow that makes it super easy to use that. So containers existed before, but Docker really made them popular and easy to use. And the particular tools of mass innovation that we're focusing on right now, the Docker platform, is really a tool to help program the internet. Not only program, create software that runs on cloud computing or on-premise, but also can be used for IoT or software that runs in cars. Docker really can run in lots of different places. It's multi-architecture. It runs on lots of different types of machines. So the way we're building that platform is in layers. And so we start at the lower layer, which is we're building it on top of standards. And so the standard for containers is done in a Linux Foundation project that's called OCI, that we created with 40 other vendors and the gracious help of the Linux Foundation. And there we built two standards, one for container images and one for the container runtime. And so Docker provided the reference implementation for the container runtime, which is called RunC. So that's the reference implementation of the specification. So you have a layer of standards. And then on top of that, this is built on top of infrastructure. And infrastructure, I consider myself a software plumber. When I present myself, usually to people who are not technical, I tell them, I'm a software plumber. I just assemble things together and create systems. Infrastructure components are what helps you build your own container system and container platform. So at Docker, we have all these infrastructure components as part of a project we call the MOBI project. So that's the upstream, the open source upstream from Docker that has lots of the components that we're using in order to build Docker. And lots of these components actually more and more are in C and CF. So for example, Containerd is one such component. It's the core container runtime that Docker is using. We donated that to CNCF. On top of that, we build a development platform that is easy to use, that developers can use on their Mac or Windows, on their laptop. And it's a very easy to use developer platform. And then for people who go in enterprises and who want to put that in production, we provide a commercial product that's called Docker Enterprise Edition. So Docker CE Community Edition is the developer platform that's based on the open source bits. Docker Enterprise Edition has additional features that are targeted towards enterprise users who want to put containers in production. So what does the layers of a container platform look like? It looks something like that. At the bottom, you have something to do infrastructure management. On top of it, you need an operating system. On top of that, you have a container runtime. And then on top of that, you have an orchestration component. And at the top, you have application services. What does it look like for Docker? The platform we're building looks something like that. At the bottom, we have a component that's called InfraKit that we're using in our editions for AWS and other cloud providers to just manage the infrastructure declaratively. All these projects are open source. This is an open source project. We talked about giving it to the Cloud Native Foundation. It's still under discussion whether it will go there or not. But it's an interesting project to take a look at for managing your infrastructure declaratively. And it has drivers for lots of different cloud providers. On top of that, you have LinuxKit, which is a kit to develop your own Linux distribution that's very lightweight and secure and portable. So that's what we're using to create Docker for Mac and Docker for Windows. And essentially, it's a Linux distribution that's based on containers. So you just have a kernel in there, and you specify the kernel as a Docker image of the kernel version that you want to put in there. On top of it, we have Containerd, and then which is our core container runtime. And then on top of it, the system services are running themselves as containers, and you specify the privileges of these containers using the OCI specification for capabilities and things like that. On top of that, you have Containerd, which is our core container runtime. It's a pretty successful project in CNCF, and we're very happy to have it in there. Recently, in Kubernetes 1.8, there's a project in Kubernetes that we've been working on with Google called CRI Containerd, which is a container runtime interface that allows, that's the interface that allows Kubernetes to manage containers. Right now, CRI is implemented in terms of Docker. With Google, we've been working on a version called CRI Containerd that allows you, that will allow Kubernetes to use Containerd directly. And we're working on, so Containerd is already present in Docker. We're approaching a 1.0 version of Containerd, and we're working pretty actively to put that in Docker in order to leverage that. On top of it, you have our orchestration layer, which is called SwarmKit. And it's doing a lot of stuff. It's having a RAF store, so a store that's replicated across nodes. It plays the same role that etcd is playing in the Kubernetes world. Node identity, secrets, routing mesh, overlay networking, and then an orchestration engine in there. So Mark talked about that. You can get that on Ali Cloud, and it's a very easy to use orchestration platform that runs both on Linux and Windows. And on top of that, you have application services. So the way it works is you have all these infrastructure components that you see on the left that are open source. We're assembling them in the MOBI project. So the MOBI project is a place where all these components are assembled. And so these components themselves can be part of CNCF or other foundation or come from other places. Then we assemble them in the MOBI project and we create these distributions or assemblies that we're using to build Docker CE and Docker EE. So this MOBI project, if you go to GitHub MOBI/MOBI, you will see the assemblage of all the components that help us build Docker CE, and then we add some other more proprietary component to build Docker EE that's targeted at enterprises. And so the platform we're building is a platform to build, ship, and run any applications anywhere. It runs on any hardware, so physical, virtual machines, or any cloud provider. It runs Windows and Linux. And then on top of that, you have the Docker platform, and you can run any type of apps on top of that. And it works both for developers and operations teams. So that's what we're building at Docker. There are two versions. Community Edition is free and open source, and there you can get it from all these different platforms. You can get it on your Mac, on your laptop, on Windows, but also on Linux servers like Ubuntu, Fedora. You can get it for AWS, and you can get it from Ali Cloud. The Enterprise Edition, the difference is that it is certified on the hardware or infrastructure on top of which it runs, so you get support with it. And you get a lot of features like a role-based access control, integration with LDAP or an Active Directory, and stuff like that. So this one runs on the type of platform that typically run in the enterprise, Ubuntu, Windows Server, So that's what's used to run containers, Windows containers on Windows. It runs on Azure, CentOS, SUSE, Red Hat, AWS, Oracle, and AliCloud. Now I want to talk about what I call the Docker way, the Docker DAO. So I'm a big fan of Lao Tzu, and I've read the Tao Te Ching. And when I went to China, I thought, okay, the theme I wanted to talk about was about this these two aspects of software in the enterprise today, where people have lots of legacy applications that they need to containerize or move to the cloud or be more agile with. And then on the other hand, they're building all these new applications with microservices. And to me, there were some concepts in Taoism that really translate really well the philosophy behind Docker. So let me go through that. So first, the philosophy behind Docker is that the best tools get out of the way, adapt to you, and make the powerful simple. That's really the design principle that we're following when we're building software tools for developers and for ops. And I think that's really what made Docker very successful. It's very easy to use. It made containers easy to use for everybody. Now, talking about Taoism, I'm a big fan of Lao Tzu, and I love that Taiwanese cartoonist called Tsai Chi-shung. He wrote a cartoon version of the Tao Te Ching, and I just took some of the illustrations from his books. I really love his books. It's a great way to get introduced to all these ideas. So the first concept that I found super relevant for Docker is called Wu Wei. I hope I pronounce it correctly. So Wu Wei, as I understand it, it means effortless action. And there's another concept that's called Wu Wei Wu, which is action without action. And this to me, in Taoism, it really means that thing that can be soft can actually be very hard, and that if you follow the way, you can achieve a lot without any action. And to me, that corresponds really well to what we're doing at Docker with the modernization of traditional applications. We have a whole program around that allows you to take existing application. You don't need to change any code, and you can Dockerize them and move them on-premise or in the cloud on top of Docker Enterprise Edition. We have a set of tools that our partners are using in order to do that. And when I say not changing any line of code, I highly recommend you to look at the Docker keynote for DockerCon for next week. So it will be live streamed. I built the demo that we're going to show in the keynote. And the demo is essentially an old Java app from 2000 called the Java Pet Store. If there are some developers in there, maybe you've heard about that. If there are some old developers, because it's a really old app, it's 18 years old. And we just take the app as is, and we're using a tool to just take the WAR file out of it and put that into a container with a newer version of Java and Tomcat. And you don't need to touch the source code at all, and then you can start adding value to that application. So that's the notion behind MTA. Mark, actually, I'm very interested in what he presented this morning, that open source tool that by Alibaba, which is a slightly different angle. There you have some source code, and the tool will recognize what type of application it is and create a Docker file and a Docker Compose file for you. The tools we're using at Docker is more about, hey, this is my application, it's already compiled. Just create a Docker file that lets me like containerize that without even touching the source code. So these two approaches are very complementary. Some will work for certain type of applications and other will work with others. But to me, that corresponds, that modernization of traditional applications really corresponds to the Wu Wei concept in Taoism. Yeah, and so when you're following the way and you use these tools that let you modernize applications without coding, this can be very effective without doing too much effort. So this effortless action is really something that that corresponds very well to the Docker philosophy. Then there's another concept that's called, I think it's called Sheeran. Do I pronounce that correctly? Sheeran? Sheeran, which means naturalness. And naturalness means following the way of the universe instead of fighting it. And that gives you a lot of power. And the way I understand that and how it relates to what we're building at Docker, is the 12 factor rules that Dan talked about. So following the way of the universe in this case to me for cloud native applications, it means creating applications that are a set of microservices with bounded context, that are container-based, that are stateless, where you manage the state into infrastructure-managed data services, and where there's no coupling in there between your different services. So that's kind of the modern way of building applications. And one of the things that Docker is very powerful at is it lets you use both. You can modernize traditional applications and create new applications based on microservices. So to me, the Docker DAO, the Docker way, is really about Wu Wei, modernizing traditional applications without coding, and Sheeran, creating microservices application with the container platform that started the container revolution. So these are the two concepts that I think are important. And that Docker is very good at providing a platform for. So let's talk a little bit about modernizing traditional applications. Nowadays, in most large enterprise companies, 80% of the budget is stuck in maintenance of existing applications. And IT managers and CIOs are more and more asked to innovate in order to survive in a very competitive environment where new applications really make a business difference. And in order to innovate, they need to cut into these 80% using maintenance. And so the way to do that is to use Docker in order to modernize your traditional applications. You start with an existing application, you use some tools that I talked to you about to containerize it, convert that to a container, put that into a registry. So Docker Enterprise Edition comes with a trusted registry that has access control and a whole set of capabilities like image promotions and things like that. Then you can deploy it on any modern infrastructure, whether on-premise or in the cloud. Docker Enterprise Edition works on both. And then you can apply modern methodologies like CI/CD. So that's what Mark demoed earlier with the Jenkins integration, where when you're making changes to your application, you just push the changes automatically. And then you can start to apply microservices modernization. And here what I'm talking about is even an existing application, by adding microservices to it, you can add business value to it. An example that I've seen recently is by just adding a few services like an Nginx proxy in front of an old Java application, an open source OAuth implementation, you can add Google authentication to any old traditional application without changing the source code. And then you can start breaking your monolithic application and start cutting away at it and creating the new functionality in terms of microservices. So that's the modernization of traditional application. And it really allows you to cut into these 80%. And it allows you to have like great cost savings. So this is an example from MetLife, who talked at DockerCon last year. They did a consolidation of VMs, and they had a 70% consolidation ratio for their applications that were running on VMs by containerizing them. And so they had a cost savings of the order of 40%. So they had a lot of leverage by doing that modernization. We see more and more enterprises doing that nowadays. The other aspect is to create new native microservice cloud native applications. And so for that, I highly advise you to go to the website of my friend Chris Richardson. We used to work together at VMware. He was part of the Spring team. He has this website where he talks about the design patterns for building microservices applications. This is a very good page. Chris is a great teacher. I highly advise you to invite him. He loves to travel as well. And I know for a fact that he loves Chinese food, so you should invite him to your next conference. So he talks really well about the different design patterns for building microservices applications. And so the Docker platform, running both on Windows and Linux, allows you to create these. It's a very natural platform for creating these modern microservice-based applications. Actually, the visualization there is from a tool that Adrian Cockcroft created to visualize your microservice architecture. This is an example of the kind of things that our users, our enterprise users of Docker Enterprise Edition, are building with Docker. So it goes anywhere from automated development pipeline at Activision. ADP is using that for traditional, both traditional and microservices application. Société Générale, same thing. MetLife, it's really about migrating these traditional applications. Visa is all about the new architecture. They're doing more microservice. But what you can see there, that it's all over the map. Many companies are doing both. And I think we'll see that pattern a lot in the future. So the Docker way is really about modernizing traditional applications and creating microservice-based applications. And if you haven't read the Tao Te Ching in a long time, I advise you to go back to it. So Docker in China. So China is very advanced in its adoption of Docker. I think it's the number three country worldwide for Docker adoption. So at Docker, we are super interested into getting in that market. And the best, one of the best users of Docker in China was Alibaba. And it's also the best partner for us to come to China. So we announced a partnership with Alibaba last year at this conference, and the partnership was launched in April this year. So if you want to buy Docker Enterprise Edition, you can buy it from Alibaba, which have an exclusivity in China. If you're going to the Docker booth, I think we're in D3, you can find some of the Alibaba engineers can help you get Docker there. Oops, sorry. Sorry, that was a little bit fast. Oops. Yeah, so Docker and Alibaba, it's a strong partnership that will help modernize IT for Chinese enterprises. And we're very hopeful about this partnership. You can find me on Twitter at Chanazon. I'm Chanazon on WeChat as well, so you can add me in there. On Weibo, I'm a happy French geek in Chinese. And then you can find this presentation. I will just put it on my slide share. You can download it from there. So I'll let you take a picture of that. I'll upload it as soon as I'm done this afternoon. And then in order to get to learn more about MTA, you can go to docker.com/MTA to learn about modernization of traditional applications. All right. And then you can come at the booth we have two talks. One at 10:30, Introduction to Docker Enterprise Edition, and one at 2:30 called Modernize Traditional Application with Docker Enterprise Edition at the conference. You can come to the booth in D3. That's what our booth looks like. We have lots of swag. You'll need to deploy a container to get one. And for those of us who are traveling, it's next week, so it's a little bit last moment, but we're having DockerCon Europe. I think it will be streamed, so you can watch the keynote from there. There will be a lot of interesting demos and announcements there next week. So that's for the booth. The last thing I wanted to touch upon is we launched a Docker professional certification. So if you're a Docker professional, now you can get certified. It will launch, the first exams are happening next week at DockerCon Europe, but the global registration, including China, will start in October 2017. You can learn more about that at success.docker.com/certification. And if you're a container professional, this is a certification that really is worthwhile looking at. Thank you. Now, maybe we can have some time for a few questions.
Thank you.
Should I take the earpiece? Sorry. Yes?
我们接下来有一些提问的一些时间, 然后大家会不会对刚刚的分享有一些那些小问题可以提问一下?
Hello, thank you for your presentation. I think it's a very interesting presentation. I just have some little questions about, actually, our company has using DocSwarm quite widely in our CI/CD service. But recently, there are some suggestions from some other colleagues they would like to suggest we should use Kubernetes instead of DocSwarm. So I would like to get some suggestions from you, and how should we evaluate which kind of technology would be the best choice for us? Thank you.
Yeah, so the question is essentially, can you in 30 seconds tell me whether I should choose Kubernetes or Swarm?
Yeah, currently it's quite open, but I think maybe the best thing is something which suits us the most, but Kubernetes also seems an attractive choice. So
yeah. I want to speak to that. As Dan said, Docker, we're part of CNCF, and we participated in the creation of CNCF back 2 years ago. I'm actually the representative of Docker on the CNCF board. And Kubernetes was announced at DockerCon 2014. So at Docker, even if we have our own orchestration technology with SwarmKit, the reason we built that instead of using Kubernetes at that time when we built SwarmKit is because we needed a lot of security features that were really not present in Kubernetes at the time for our enterprise customers. But as you saw in the diagram that I showed about the platform, our platform is made of lots of different components. And these components can be replaced or changed, and so you can adopt different pieces as time goes by. Right now, our enterprise offering is based on Swarm, and I think in SwarmKit there are lots of interesting security aspects that Kubernetes is only starting to catch up to. But Kubernetes is a super interesting project. We have been collaborating with Google and all the other rest of the community in CNCF for 2 years now. We gave Containerd to the CNCF in order for Containerd to be a great base for the container runtime for Kubernetes. Recently at Mobi Summit, we demoed the lib network driver, so our networking layer, working as CNI plugins. So CNI is the networking model that's used in Kubernetes. So I'd say, using Swarm or Kubernetes, we need a longer discussion. It really depends on your requirements. If you're an enterprise user today, I'd say in Docker EE, there's really a lot of value, especially in terms of security, that will be harder to get from a Kubernetes distribution. But Kubernetes is certainly a super interesting orchestration project that we're looking very closely at Docker. and that we are very happy to collaborate with. That would be my take there.
Okay, thank you for your answer.
Yes.
It's a very nice talk. I have a question on whether you have comments on cloud native architecture and hybrid cloud.
Yes.
So do you think hybrid cloud is a cloud native architecture?
Oh, yes. Oh, that's one of my favorite topics. So cloud native and hybrid cloud. I'll actually tell you a personal story. So when I was at Google, we invented the PaaS category, the platform as a service category. And at some point, we created a version in 2010 that was called Google App Engine for Business that was really targeted at enterprises. And I personally was the one in charge of getting to enterprises and starting to sell that to them. And I remember going to see some CIOs in France especially, like very conservative people, and telling them, hey, with this new platform as a service, you just push your code, and at Google, we manage it all, and we just build it and deploy it, and you don't need to do anything. And they told me, they laughed at me. They told me, hey, we want our data to be reside in France. We want some of our services to be in our own data center. I know it's a feeling that happens a lot in Germany as well and lots of European countries. Sometimes it's for regulatory reasons. Sometimes it's really for competitive reasons that people want to hold part of their applications inside the firewall. And that's actually the reason why I left Google in 2011 to join VMware, because Cloud Foundry was really designed to be that platform as a service based on open source for the hybrid world, where you could deploy it on top of VMware inside the firewall, and then you could deploy it on Amazon or Alibaba in public cloud and leverage the same workflow on both. And then Docker appeared. And to me, Docker is kind of the best of both worlds. It's really the platform that's ideal for running the same stuff inside the firewall and in the cloud. Now, to go in the... So to me, the technical foundations for building hybrid applications that where one part is in the cloud, one part is in is on-prem are here. Now, in practice, some of the limitations there are tied to networking. And so you need to have your networking team work pretty closely with the cloud providers. Some cloud providers let you have a private networking link between your on-premise infrastructure and your cloud infrastructure, and then do some measurement and see what works for which type of apps. So what I can see in the short term is that people are going to have the same kind of platforms like Docker EE on-prem, like with the AppSara intelligence platform in China, with Docker EE on top, and then Docker EE in the cloud, and they will deploy some apps inside and some apps outside. But then with time, with the network links getting better and the latencies being more managed between cloud and on-prem, I think we'll see more and more applications leveraging both. Any other questions? Yes?
Just to follow up on that Kubernetes question, are you planning to do anything with CNCF in the future? Say, playing any role? That's a short question. And longer one is, what's your plan for the China market?
Okay.
You know, now we're doing something with Alibaba, and anything planned for the near future that you're going to open up the China market and
sure,
do a lot more with it?
So let's talk about the two questions. So the first question is about our involvement in CNCF. So actually, it was really fun to have dinner with Dan here in Beijing, because I see him more often than I see my boss these days. Basically, in the past few months, I personally was in charge of giving three Docker projects to CNCF. So Containerd first, then we tried with InfraKit. It didn't go through yet. Then we did notary, and notary, I think the vote is in, and it should get in pretty soon. As I told him yesterday, we have one more in the cards for CNCF. So basically, my job these days is to take some of these infrastructure components that we talked about that are part of the Mobi project and give them to CNCF when it makes sense. So we have a lot of involvement there, and we'll have a lot more in the future. The other aspect is CRI, Containerd, that I talked about and all that. You'll see a lot of that talked in details at DockerCon and Mobi Summit next week. And then for the second question on the China market side, so really our strategy in China is just to follow the lead of Alibaba. We're creating the platform that allows you to modernize your applications, your traditional application, and develop new microservices type of applications on-prem and in the cloud. Alibaba is our partner for both in China, and that's our strategy. Any other questions? Oh, yes, over there.
Thanks for your presentation. Actually, in our company, we are using Mesos and Marathon to manage our cluster and for deployment. And but people suggest us to we could also use Docker with Mesos and Marathon. So for you, what will be the gain if we use Docker above these two frameworks already?
So using Docker with the two frameworks, or?
Basically it's like use Mesos and Marathon to deploy Docker images on machines.
Yeah, so I'm pretty biased here. I would advise you to use Docker Swarm instead and
okay.
deploy a Swarm cluster. That would be my recommendation.
Okay, so what will be the gain if we switch to Swarm?
So what you'll gain is a lot of security features like cryptographic node identity, a very easy setup, some support for lots of different infrastructure, the fact that it works on both Windows and Linux, the fact that it's easy to deploy on Alibaba, and that you can even buy a version that you can host on-premise.
Okay, thank you.
All right, yes?
I have one question, but right now you are talking about Docker, but as I know, recently some serverless, right? Serverless is more popular and function as service. Maybe from my point, if I deploy some microservice application, I more want to choose some function as service and serverless. But in future, I'm not sure what's the plan for Docker to manage this piece. Yeah.
So I can talk about that. So the topic there is that the future of microservice is a type of platform and frameworks on top that are called serverless.
Yes.
And actually, I'm hosting a panel at DockerCon next week with three of the most popular serverless projects. OpenFAS, which is running both on Swarm and Kubernetes. Mm-hmm. OpenWhisk, which is a project in Apache that was donated by IBM. And FN, which is a new project that was open sourced by Oracle at Java 1 month ago. That has some really interesting aspects in Java where they're using some Java language construct natively for asynchronous functions. So to me, serverless is a really interesting way of structuring your app. Basically, you structure your app as a set of functions that responds to events. There's still a lot of work to do, and actually our team participates in the CNCF serverless working group. So if you're interested in serverless, I highly advise you to read the report they published recently and to participate in that working group because there is a lot of interesting topics that are raised there. And one of the topics that is of a lot of interest to me is what are we going to do in terms of standardization for the type of events that your function respond to? There are lots of serverless platforms that are proprietary, the ones from Microsoft and Amazon. And all these, they have their own type of events. for the platform that will deploy on top of Docker, one of the value of Docker is to provide you portability. And so the serverless platform you run on top should provide you that portability too. So to me, one of the keys that is still missing is that standardization of the event sources. And there's some discussion in CNCF about what we should do about that. So it's a fascinating topic. We'll talk about that at DockerCon next week, and I think the panel will be streamed. So that's another good resource.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks. All right, thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
大家可能是最近3到4年才对容器技术的优势耳熟能详，但早在2011年的时候，阿里巴巴内部就已经上线了基于LXC的容器技术产品，并成功支持了历年的双十一大规模场景。今天，阿里立足兼容并包的原则，积极将阿里容器技术的高隔离强稳定性等特性与开源社区相结合。下面，就让我们一起来探秘阿里容器技术的未来与思考。有请阿里巴巴技术专家孙宏亮为我们带来的分享。
Hi, everyone. Actually, I'm a maintainer of Docker Swarm. So I recommend using Swarm as well. My slides, okay. 切换成中文啊，今天我的话题是阿里巴巴集团容器技术的现状与未来线路。就像刚才介绍的一样，其实容器技术啊 ，Docker 做了一个创新之举啊，它的容器技术、镜像技术都非常的 popular。但是呢，其实类似于C Group Namespace 的一些技术啊，由来已久。那阿里巴巴集团内部呢，其实在2011年就使用了这些技术啊。我首先介绍一下我自己啊，刚才 Dan 以及 Patrick 都已经介绍到了他们的一些career。那其实我的 career 呢，和他们有一些类似的地方，那就是我基本上是他们两位的后面的3-4个环节。为什么呢？因为我一开始接触 Cloud 的时候呢，其实一开始接触的是 Cloud Foundry。后面呢又接触了类似于 Buildpack 这一些技术，那后来的话是 Container Docker， 现在的话来到阿里做容器技术方面的一些工作啊。那在社区方面呢，我非常热衷于开源社区，在社区当中也贡献了很多内容，现在是 Swarm 的 Maintainer。 那我今天主要介绍的 Agenda 呢，主要包含4个方面。第一个方面主要是介绍阿里容器技术它的一个现状，包括它的一些技术发展，同时呢它现在到底是运用到了一个什么样的规模，什么样的一个级别。其实阿里的容器技术呢叫做 Ponch， 后面我也会和大家介绍到 Ponch 是一个什么样的缘由，为什么叫做 Ponch。 那 Ponch 其实它在这个阿里巴巴内部存在，其实肯定有它的独特之处，那我会介绍一下 Ponch 的独特特性，最后我会和大家分享一下 Ponch 未来的一个发展之路吧。那我相信首先大家对阿里巴巴的这样一个业务规模啊，肯定会有一个比较清楚的认识，比如说说到双十一，比如说说到现在的一些数据分析的一些服务啊，这里面肯定需要大规模的集群数据服务规模。那阿里巴巴容器技术呢，在集团内部啊，其实现在已经覆盖了集团大部分的 BU， 包括现在阿里巴巴收购了很多的一些集团公司收购了一些公司啊，那大部分的 BU 都已经采用了容器技术。那其实就像现在每时每刻阿里巴巴内部常规规模下，这个容器的规模呢都是在于几十万个这样的一个规模。那在线业务呢现在也可以做到100%的容器化。那说到100%的容器化，其实我后面也会和大家分享一下为什么阿里的容器可以做到100%的 Docker 化100%的容器化啊。那其实它在容器技术的这样一个改良方面做了很多的工作。那在覆盖的场景方面呢，其实包括运行模式啊， 编程语言啊、技术栈啊这个方面，我们都用容器来帮我们来实现。其实我们很多的业务啊，在上云的过程当中，阿里内部甚至有一些这样的一些方向，那就是我们首先要做到所有的业务都容器化，第二步呢，我们需要做到这些业务都可以统一的进行调度。覆盖的业务其实会非常多了，包括像蚂蚁一些交易啊，一些中间件的一些服务，包括 B2B， 还有优酷，大家都知道啊，菜鸟、高德啊，阿里云这边我们也会容器技术也会输出到阿里云上面。那刚才介绍了一下阿里容器技术 Ponch 的一个现状啊，现在再来介绍一下这个 Ponch。 那 Ponch 呢，大家肯定会这个单词比较生僻啊，大家肯定会疑惑一下，哎，它是什么样的意思啊？那可以说 Ponch 的意思呢是一个育儿袋的意思，那可能是一个母亲，育儿袋，baby。 那我们也是隐喻这样一个 Ponch 呢可以做到贴身呵护应用。那为什么会贴身呵护应用呢？那这个可能和现在社会当中行业当中一些传统的一些观念啊有一些差异化。那比如说很多的应用都是 application centric， 那我们认为一个 application 怎么来更好的呵护它呢？其实这里面需要一些更多的技术支撑。那这个 Ponch 呢，就像刚才所说的，它是源于2011年，当时我们是基于LXC 来建设这样一个 Ponch。那阿里内部的容器技术产品呢也在当年上线了。那从2015年开始呢，其实那个时候Docker 技术在全球渐渐的变得越来越的受欢迎啊。那个时候呢我们渐渐的吸收 Docker 的镜像技术来帮助我们内部的业务分发尽可能做到非常的标准化。那这个方面啊，不得不说啊，阿里内部的容器技术呢，它结合了很多阿里内核的特性，其实大幅的提高了容器技术的这样一个隔离性啊。其实如果大家对于底层的技术接触的非常多的话，肯定知道容器技术呢它是非常依赖于内核的，是吧？那安全性呢其实也在内核隔离上就会体现出差异。那这里面那阿里它会结合自身的内核 patch 来做到更可靠的一些隔离性，包括在这里面上面大家肯定也听说过，在行业当中会有 RunV 甚至是 Clear Container 这些技术，那阿里其实在这个方面也做了一些支持。那就像我刚才说阿里的现状，阿里容器现状的时候提到啊，那 Ponch 技术现在也已经大规模的部署于阿里集团内部啊。那阿里容器技术虽然说是内部逐渐走出来的这样一个技术啊，其实在生态方面呢其实是一个非常开放的心态。那首先在 CNCF 这一方面呢，阿里的容器技术现在正在努力的去和 Kubernetes 这个生态啊做一些更多的一些支持方面的工作，来建立一些标准，包括在于 CI 方面的一些建设啊。那说到 Docker 方面的一些合作呢，我相信刚才 Patrick 以及毅力也都介绍到了啊，甚至大家如果去看一下阿里巴巴对于 Docker 生态的一些贡献啊，大家也会发现其实阿里巴巴的贡献在于全球 Docker 贡献当中的前20，这个也是一个非常难能可贵的成绩。那在这个方面呢，我再介绍了一下现状方面呢，再来介绍一下 Ponch 的演进之路啊。在介绍 Ponch 演进之路的时候呢，首先还是先来和大家介绍一下这个基础架构啊，它的一个历史的演进。那我们会发现啊，说到这个的时候啊，说到这个架构演变的时候呢，曾经我可以和大家说一个小插曲。前一阵子我女朋友问我一个问题，她说什么是分布式？我怎么来回答的呢？那当然是集中式和分布式了。那我就说，你哥哥开了一个五金店，是吧？ 那怎么样能让这个规模越来越大，同时又能保证这个店的安全可靠呢？我就这样问，我说，他说，我跟他讲，那肯定是需要，哎，先在你这个城市周边去开一个分店，是吧？管理呢，集中化，那就是 controller 的概念，那就是这样的一套演进方式，来渐渐的保证，哎，电商业务啊，或者说你的这样一个实体店啊，能渐渐的分布式的管理起来。那这个其实在软件当中也是这样子，那我们集中式的软件呢，需要通过这种方式来分布式。那这是我们的管理模式，同时呢，我们也需要来更好的运维这些业务。那运维的一些方式呢，大家可以想象一下，在分布式的环境下，之前的运维方式更多的是一种分散的模式。那现在呢，我们渐渐的会采取云的这些概念来更好的管理起来，自动化的这些运维工作能管理起来。所以现在大家感受到的是，我们的运维仅仅是在某一个 dashboard， 某一个统一的 entry point， 只需要操作一小部分，那分布式的东西都可以帮我们管理起来。所以我们的运维能力呢，正从分散渐渐的转向云化。那这是架构方面的一些演变啊。那我们来看看资源使用方面，它是一个怎样的一个演变的方式。那我相信，就像一开始Patrick 在介绍到Netscape 的时候，那就是 server， physical server， 一开始都是物理机。那物理机在当时那个时代可以说是统治了很长的一段时间。而后呢，我相信这个时候也是 Patrick 为什么选择 VMware 的一个很大的 reason 啊。那 VM 的诞生，保证了资源可以更细力度的来划分，也能更好的来进行管理。那我们会发现啊，虚拟机的管理更多的还是在资源层面。其实我们有的时候啊，尤其是像阿里巴巴这样的一个大型的公司，其实我们更需要技术能很好很快的来响应我们的业务，能面向我们的业务。那虚拟机这一方面可能做的还差那么一点，但是容器技术就完全革新了这一部分。容器技术的话，它能很方便的做到面向 application。那这个的话也是资源使用它的一个演变啊。那容器发展呢，从阿里内部运维和应用的视角来看容器呢，其实这里面呢，往往会和大家想象中的不一样。虽然容器技术非常的受欢迎，但是呢，这里面总有一些，就是对于运维和开发来讲，总有一些边界需要去分清楚。那我们一开始容器技术它推崇 application centric， 也就是说，哎，一个容器当中啊只运行一个应用，其他的辅助的一些服务啊之类的都没有。那这样子的时候，运维人员习惯了他常用的运维习惯之后，面对这种情况，他肯定两眼一摸黑，出了问题怎么定位，是吧？出了问题怎么来恢复现场，这个肯定也是运维人员非常担心的一个问题。好，那比如说容器技术它的网络啊，和现有的一些网络基础设施其实完全不是一个模型。我们曾经经常会举这样一个例子，通过容器技术你可以一下子扩展几千个容器，是吧？哎，非常的 fancy。 但是你会发现这里面同样有很多的问题要面临。那我的网络怎么来跟上？我的 IP 有这么多吗？是吧？都会有各种各样的一些问题。那这个时候你会发现技术在真正进行落地的过程当中，要承接这些技术的人会有不一样的思考。那甚至比如说能够 SSH 登录啊，登录后能看到一个独立的文件系统啊，资源隔离啊，这个方面其实都是运维人员需要考虑的一些问题啊。那你会发现啊，容器技术诞生之后，我们真正要做到容器技术这方面的一些内容呢，我们可以采取一些措施。比如说我们可以手工 hack 实现容器的一些要素，我们容器需要有独立 IP， 那我们可以有虚拟网卡来做网桥，能够 SSH 呢，那我们可以在内部啊再去部署一个 SSHD daemon。 那 部署了之后怎么来管理呢？这就变成了另外一个问题啊。甚至我们可以通过 change root 啊，类似于 mount namespace 来做到一些隔离，资源的隔离性呢，我们可以做到C group 啊 namespace 来实现。这个就是非常 general 的容器技术。那阿里的容器从一一年到现在，中间其实也才中间其实一些历程呢，也是首先引入了 Linux container LXC， 但是 LXC 那个时候还不是特别的完善，甚至在内核的发展方面啊，我认为容器技术类似于 Docker 的诞生，也促使 kernel 在不断的演进，不断的在变革。那内核的可见性这个方面啊，比如说现在像 LXC file system， 它就做到了很多可见性方面的隔离。那这个方面我可以举一个例子啊，大家在容器里面，大家可以去看一下 free， 执行一下 free 这个命令，大家肯定知道，这个时候我们获取的内存资源其实是宿主机的资源，并不是容器的资源。大家肯定知道这个问题啊。那对于一些 Java 的一些应用，也许它在分配资源的时候，往往需要先知道我到底能使用多少资源，它才能更好的为我们的业务来服务。那这种场景其实借助现有的一些容器技术，它就很难百分之百的实现啊。那另外一个方面的话，内核磁盘空间的一些配额的一些 patch 也和容器技术做了一些结合，那这就是渐渐演变出来阿里的这样一个容器技术。当然我们这个时候又回到了2015年，那 Docker 的镜像技术诞生了。这个镜像技术呢，可以很好的帮我们做到这个业务的交付。那这个时候呢，我们就把这部分的一些优势结合进来，形成了 Punch。那 Punch 呢，未来再去进一步的演变。那我们再来看一下，从业务的角度来讲，从技术推广、技术落地的角度来讲，来看一下Punch 的这样一个发展历程啊。其实，在2015年的7月呢。其实大家想一下，其实已经是两年前啊，那雏形诞生，跑在阿里 kernel 上。那2015年的8月份呢，其实当时就先于 Docker 解决了这样一个 daemon 问题。如果大家了解 Docker 发展的一些生态啊，容器技术以前更多的是 daemon 直接管理容器，这个会有一定的问题，比如说 daemon 的升级会带动你现在跑的一些业务会比较大的影响。daemon 当掉，容器所有的都当掉，那这是一个现状。那后来呢，社区里面就开发出了 containerd 来统一的接管所有的 container， 使得 daemon 的稳定性呢和容器的生命周期进行一个结合。那其实早在2015年的8月份呢，阿里容器技术 Punch 就解决了这样的一个问题。那2015年的12月份呢，可以在阿里的一个发布系统上啊，来部署发布 Docker 的镜像。那2016年的2月份呢，主站第一个镜像化的这样一个应用呢，就可以上线，真正的来服务于大家。所以这个时候大家可以想象一下，也许大家在淘宝上买了一样东西，后面的支撑正是Punch 啊。那在2016年的4月份呢？Punch 支持 P2P 的链式分发。那 P2P 的链式分发呢是什么样的一个场景呢？我可以和大家介绍一下。那我们阿里内部在玩容器的时候啊，不可能说是几个 Docker 几个 daemon， 那往往更多的是一个集群化，几千台甚至上万台服务器。大家想象一下，这个时候大家在下镜像的时候啊，这个网络带宽有多大？要发布出来一个应用，这个应用呢可能有1000个实例、5000个实例，这个下载镜像的这个负载大家可以想象一下啊，镜像有可能就是几百兆甚至一个 G 的，那这个压力其实很大的。那在这种情况下呢，阿里被迫采取一种被迫使用一种新的技术来实现更好的镜像传输，那就是支持 P2P 的链式分发。那也就是说在整个集群当中啊，有一个统一的 registry， 那镜像呢下载一份甚至是少份，那其余的呢在 P2P 这种方式来传播，来 降低这个网络贷款的压力啊。那2016年的五月份呢，其实就当时就做了一个决定，那是内部所有的主站呢，全部要做到 Ponchi 化，全部要通过这个容器的方式来交付啊。那2016年的七月呢，阿里容器就升级为 Ponchi， 那也就是在去年的双十一呢，其实核心应用的整个单元呢已经 Ponchi 化，而2017年的三月呢，主站100%就可以做到这一点。另外，主站的交易呢，大家都知道啊，交易往往会更多的体现出来很多的敏感性啊，那这个方面也可以做到这个方面。那我们再来看看这个阿里的容器技术啊，与 Docker， 因为 Docker 现在是一个非常受欢迎的这样一个软件，大家肯定在开发运维的过程当中都用到。那我们可以来看一下这里面的一些区别啊。那包括在 CPU 啊、内存、进程隔离这个方面呢，大家更多的都是采用 Linux kernel 这方面的一些内容。那在磁盘空间隔离方面呢，其实大家可以认为 Ponchi 它存在自己的一些优势。那 Docker 的话，更多的是会去借助更多的 Graph Driver， 像 AUFS 啊、Device Map 啊、Overlay FS 啊，来实现文件系统视角的隔离。但是在于资源 quarter 的一些隔离方面呢，其实这里面的维度呢，还需要我们来更多的做得更进一步。那这里面呢，阿里容器技术呢，它通过自己的一种方式来实现。另外一个方面啊，其实在隔离方面啊，大家提到网络隔离的时候，其实真正去用的话，发现网络隔离还欠缺一些。那网络隔离它更多的是用到了像Net namespace， 它做到了像是网络站的一些隔离，就是你不能用我的网卡，我不能用你的网卡。但是对于网络来讲，我们需要看待的角度会更广泛一些。那比如说网络带宽怎么算的，网络流量是怎么算的，尤其是在云上，尤其是对于一些比如说类似于视频服务啊，如果要使用容器的话，其实这里面他们才是最关心的是这种东西。那这个方面呢，其实阿里容器技术呢，它是使用内核的一些CoreOS 模块来实现这方面的一些隔离啊。所以说借助于内核方面呢，能帮我们实现基本的一些隔离。但是如果我们要做得更细化一些呢，内核自身也在演进。那网络模式镜像模式，一开始的话，那更多的还是采用一些非常简单的镜像模式，而并没有像Docker 那么完善的一套体系，类似于 Docker file 的一些组织方式啊，那个时候还没有。那执行引擎的话，一开始基于 LXC 啊，而 Docker 的话，它更多的是LXC libcontainer， 而 libcontainer 的话，而后也演变成了 runc， 那也贡献给了 OCI 这个基金会啊。那文件系统分层的话，这个方面如果大家了解的话啊，大家知道一开始肯定是采用了 Overlay FS， 这里面又有一些很有趣的故事，那就是 Overlay FS 它是一个 Linux kernel mainline 的一个文件系统，但是像 AUFS 呢，那可能是因为它作者可能一些原因，至今还没有进入 Linux kernel 的 mainline 啊。那资源可见性方面的话，其实一开始阿里就已经做得会更完善一些。那这个也大家也很好理解啊，那就是阿里巴巴内部有那么多的一些应用，都是需要通过类似我刚才所说的，通过你这台机器的内存总数啊，来分配来管理这些资源的。那如果说一个容器当中看到的内存资源是整台宿主机的，那这个显然是不能接受的。也是在这个业务的驱使下，那在这部分隔离性方面呢，阿里其实很早就已经做到了。那内核支持这个方面啊，其实说实话也是阿里容器技术 Ponchi 的一个优势，这个后面我也会介绍的啊。那我们这边会来介绍一下Ponchi 的技术优势啊。首先我们认为 Ponchi 在隔离性方面呢更为丰富一些。那为什么会说更为丰富一些呢？那其实我们在于可见性啊，多维度啊， 甚至是 VM 的支持上面会更完善一些。那镜像分发也是一个非常大的特点啊。假如说咱们的数据中心当中，哎，我们的业务分发量非常大的话， P2P 我相信是一个必须要去做的这样一个事情啊。还有一个是富容器的话，待会我会讲到，那规模化的考验以及内核兼容性方面，其实也是Punch 的一个优势啊。首先我来介绍一下这个隔离性吩咐方面啊。那刚才传统容器的隔离维度呢，我相信大家也已经知道一些。那更优的容器隔离性方面呢，那主要是一些刚才所说的文件系统、配额磁盘大小、配额网络，还有一些内核资源方面啊。那这个方还有的话还是就是基于 hypervisor 的强容器隔离，就是 RunV 以及 clear container 那种方式。那一些敏感的一些业务，其实它还是需要有一个内核来帮我们来实现。另外一个方面的话，其实阿里集团非常大，内部的一些业务各种各样的都有，那我们要提供一个统一化的这样一个服务给大家的话，那这里面hypervisor 其实是非常非常需要的。我可以和大家举一个场景，很多的一些业务它都需要来定制内核的一些参数，是吧？很多的应用都需要来定制内核的参数来调优，尤其是网络的一些参数，是这样子吧？那在这种情况下，容器那在实现混布或者说是不同的应用在同样的机器上出现的时候，那可以让它来配置容器，就是 Pure 容器里面的这些配置吗？其实往往很难做到，一旦被改掉了之后，其他的应用也都受影响，这显然不是我们想看到的。另外也有一些业务呢，其实它会去管理一些内核的模块，那这个时候其实容器是很难做到 kernel 这一层面的。那这个时候呢，我们需要通过 hypervisor 的这种方式来管理。那我们可以来看一下这个 P2P 的镜像分发能力啊。那这个的话是我可以和大家从这样一个横向和纵向来介绍一下啊。这个横向的话更多的是一些 IDC 的机房，一些集群，那哎，这边是中心机房，这边是远程机房。然后纵向的话啊，更多的是一个上下层的这样一个软件架构。底层的话大家很好理解，那肯定需要很多的 Punch 来支撑。然后蜻蜓是什么呢？蜻蜓就是我们这样一个 P2P 镜像分发的这样一个软件。好，中间大家看到了 OSS， 那也就是借助了阿里云的这样一个存储来做到镜像的这样一个分发。那 Registry Mirror 以及 SuperNode， 大家会发现啊，如果我们要下载镜像首先肯定在存储上，镜像在存储在 OSS 上。那在 OSS 之上了之后，中心机房和远程机房它需要做镜像的下拉，那它就这样一个 SuperNode 会把相应的镜像拉到SuperNode 上。拉到 SuperNode 上之后呢，我们再通过 P2P 的在 Punch 呢相应的去下拉，然后这样的每个节点上的 Punch 再通过蜻蜓的这种方式 P2P 的方式再分发。那这样子的话你会发现啊，真正的话我们考虑的东西往往更多的还是在于这样一个 SuperNode。 一旦我们这个 SuperNode 可能在于更新时间方面出了一些在校验的时候出现了一些差错之后，我们的 PongD 也可以到每个中心机房的OSS 方面去下拉。那这样子的话可以大大的减少单向指向 registry 的这样一个网络压力。那这个是镜像的分发能力啊。那还有一个方面呢，其实是我非常想和大家介绍的一点 Punch 的一个特性啊，叫做富容器。那富容器呢，其实怎么说呢，因为我认为技术的发展它需要有一定的创新创造能力，那类似于Docker 之前提供的那种方式，这是一种创新能力。但是我认为技术的发展同样需要考虑怎么帮助现有的这个行业能真正的去采用技术， 这里面会考虑一些技术落地方面的一些挑战与实践啊。那我们认为呢，副容器能更好的呵护我们的应用，所以也就是 Ponch 它这个本意啊，贴身呵护应用。那行业当中对于容器的这样一个实现啊，容器里面分装这样应用的这样一个建议啊，希望 application centric， 除了这个应用，其他的东西都不要放到容器里面来，是这样子吧？那这个时候啊，我们会发现我们整个行业当中的运维模式全都变掉了。原来是针对应用的运维，现在我们会发现针对了容器的运维，我们原来的那套运维工具渐渐的会变得不适用。那这个时候，那就是现在我们会发现啊，整个容器行业当中还是有整个的 IT 行业当中啊，其实有很多的遗留应用现在还没有真正的被容器化。当然这个也是Docker 的 MTA 他考虑的一些问题啊。那其实我们也很早就意识到这一点。那我们怎么来让这个副容器更好呢？其实我们认为整个行业在转向容器的过程当中，它会有一个比较漫长的过渡期，而不是说我们采用一种极其创新的技术来教育这个市场，这个其实我觉得阻力是蛮大的。很简单，大家可以想象一下啊，如果大家在座的各位有运维人员的话，大家会发现啊，开发人员给我提的一些需求，一般情况下老板都是需要我尽快的响应的，是吧？业务开发方是吧，而不是说哎，我们的运维方式是这样子的，我们来引导开发模式，这个往往是很难的。那这个方面也就是我们在引导这个行业变迁过程当中，过渡期当中需要做的一些事情。那副容器到底做了什么样的事情呢？首先，容器内部它可以运行一个 init 进程。 init 进程它可以做什么样的事情呢？类似于管理的过程当中可以去清扫你的一些僵尸进程啊，哎，这方面的一些内容啊。同时呢，容器内部可以很有效的来运行一些系统服务。那很简单，我可以这样说一下，其实我们很多的一些系统啊，很多的一些 application 啊，都是依赖于系统服务的。syslogd 啊，还有 chrome 啊，它都会依赖这些东西。大家觉得是这样子吗？那如果我们仅仅把那些系统服务排除在容器之外的话，根本很难做到containerize。那这个时候我们就需要在内部来更好的运行一些系统服务。那这样子的话，我们给予传统运维的一个视角是无差别的。那这样子的话，也能帮助我们的业务能很好的上线。那阿里巴巴业务发展的这么快，其实更多的都我们需要在技术支撑的时候做好更好的一些响应。那同时呢，用户的体验呢，如传统的 VM， 体验如 VM， 但是不是真正的 VM 啊。那真正的 VM 我们在后面也会介绍到。那极强的应用适配性，那这样子的话，我们真正的可以做到一个应用在原来的这种运行环境下到我们副容器里面的这个运行下无差别，可以做到真正的开箱即用。那这个其实是我们做的一个比较重要的事情。当然这个也是集团应用可以100%容器化的这样一个非常非常重要的前提。那大家可以想象一下啊，那很多的集团，很多的一些企业在采用容器技术的时候，其实它未必能真正做到100%的容器化，那会有一些历史原因啊，还有一些其他方面的一些原因啊。但是 Ponch 可以帮助大家来做到这方面的一些内容。那资源的多维度隔离，这个是肯定也是可以的。那规模化考验这个方面呢，我相信这个也不难理解。那阿里巴巴有这么大的一些规模，有这么大规模的一些业务啊，那能从容的应对超大规模的负载。那2017年至今呢，容器的常规规模呢就达到了去年双11的数倍。那事故方面的话，现在没有发生重大的事故。那在兼容内核兼容性方面啊，我相信这也是一个非常重要的一些特性。为什么呢？因为之前我在整个社区当中啊，也会遇到一些技术人员和我交流，那他们经常会问到， 哎，我有一个十年前的应用，它能做到容器化吗？那我说这个强依赖于你的内核版本。那我说现在是3.10以上的内核呢可以容器化。然后你知道他回答的一句什么样的话吗？他说啊，现在内核已经发展到3.10了。他会回答我这样一句话。那你会发现在内核支持方面啊，其实容器技术呢走得更前一些。但是我们会发现很多的一些公司啊，很多的一些数据中心内核升级其实是一个非常敏感的话题。那如果它不升级，它就很难享受到容器技术的红利。那让它升吧，这又面临了一个非常大的一个技术风险。那而 POCH 它做的一个事情呢，它就是去兼容一些老版本的内核，这方面可以做到，但是呢主要为了业务我们必须这样做，是吧？那阿里内部呢仍然存有相当规模的这样一个 2.6.x32 的这样一个内核机器啊。那其实对于很多的企业来讲其实也是一样子，那很多的大型的一些企业内部的内核版本可能较为低，那其实这些资源其实有很大的技术还有很大的价值的。那 Ponch 呢它可以支持内部所有的 Linux 2.6.x 的内核，那这个方面的话也就是我可以和大家简单的介绍了一下这里面是如何来实现的。那就是很多的系统调用其实我们会把它绕过去，没有通过最直接的一种方式去做，那肯定更多的还是在于系统调用方面嘛。那部分的支持呢来源于一些内核的补丁啊，所以说这个方面是内核补丁的支持。其实另外一方面其实更多的也有我们在 Ponch 这一层面做的一些定制。好，那我们再来看一下我们 Ponch 的未来的一些路线。那我们 Ponch 在支撑了阿里这么大规模的业务量之后呢，我们采取的一个路线呢是 Open Source 开源。首先我们开源需要做我们的一些初衷，我们的宗旨肯定是拥抱生态和我们的生态来共建，把我们一些差异化的我们认为对整个行业有很大价值的一些东西呢和大家一起分享，来把这个东西来更好的一些完善。那我们过程呢我们会借由一些依赖因为大家知道啊内部肯定会有一些依赖的东西，那我们这部分东西需要借由然后第三个方面呢我们会加强一些合作来做这方面的一些工作啊。那我们 Ponch 开源的一些计划呢其实分为三个阶段。第一个方面在于孵化，那我们在最近开始呢我们会和合作伙伴共同来孵化，那外部的开发者呢我们会邀请内测，而在双十一阶段呢我们会正式的把 Ponch 开源给整个的行业整个的社区。我们会在明年的3月份呢会 roadmap 当中是第一个大版本。那我们会一如既往的拥抱生态，那首先我们在 CNCF 当中呢会去更好的兼容我们作为一个容器的解决方案，我们会更好的去做到兼容 CI， 会去实 CI， 那支持 CI 接口对接 Kubernetes， 我们也会兼容 Docker 的一些 API 接口。那这个方面其实我们认为是 Docker 的一个对行业很大的一个贡献，它规范了怎么使用规范的使用容器啊，但是我们会去兼容它，也会有一些扩展的一些地方，因为我们认为容器技术也会有一些差异化的价值可以体现出来。那我们会在 Container D 这个方面呢我们会去基于 Container D 做一些事情，另外我们也在极力的促成Container D 对于 Runtime 这个方面的丰富性支持方面，比如说怎么能更好的来在 RunC 啊RunV 啊 Clear Container 这个方面来做一些事情。同时在 CSI 这个方面呢我们也会做一些工作啊。这个是整个 Ponch 在这里面的一张图啊。上层的编排工具层面呢我们会有 Swarm 以及 Kubernetes 方面的支持，对下呢在通过 CRI 的这种方式来管理，更好的管理这样一个容器。那 Punch 的话，其实内部它会有一些功能啊，比如说热迁移啊、副容器啊、Run V Clear Container 的支持啊，以及 GPU 的一个原生支持啊。那在解耦依赖方面呢，那 Punch 会朝着一个组件化的这样一个方向来发展。我们会梳理 Punch 的内部依赖、网络存储、服务发现、发布系统等，然后把通用的一部分呢开源出来。那 Punch 正如刚才所说的，一开始会采用孵化的这种方式，那后续呢将和社区来合作共建。那孵化期间呢，阿里将与合作伙伴共同的来孵化这个 Punch 的一个开源版本。那在这边呢，那我们也宣布，阿里巴巴宣布与浙江大学 SEL 实验室呢建立一个紧密的合作。那大家国内的话，大家知道浙江大学在于容器生态其实做过很多的贡献，包括我个人的话，其实也是来自于浙江大学 SEL 实验室。那我们希望通过这样一个紧密的合作呢，能把我们这个 Punch 能一个更成熟、更富含技术，能给我们的用户带来更多价值的这种方式呢，呈现给我们整个社区以及行业。那这个方面呢，我们有浙江大学会主要会负责在 CRI 这一层面，同时以及在于 runtime 的丰富性支持方面，他们也会做出他们的一些贡献。这部分的内容的话，那主要是我介绍了阿里巴巴容器技术 Punch 啊，它的一个现状以及它的一个差异化的地方，同时未来的一个线路吧。那感谢大家。另外这方面的话是一个申请内测的二维码啊，那大家可以扫描一下。那我们会和内测开发者来一起来孵化这样的一个 Punch。好，谢谢大家。
OK， 感谢洪亮的分享。大家会不会对洪亮有什么？OK， 您先。
感谢分享啊。
嗨，你好。
那个请教一个问题，就是说，也是一点评论吧，就是说你说的有一点非常赞同，就是说现在的容器技术其实反过来对 Linux 内核提出了一些新的需求吧，因为 Linux 内核对容器的支持，包括 C group， 包括 namespace， 都是好几年前，将近十年前，引入了一些内核的，有很多都当时呢，这个谷歌也没有想到容器会用的这么多，更多的应用都在容器上跑。
对，
所以说现在可能会有很多的这种，新的需求。刚才说的这个 Java 应用跑在这个容器里面，就会出现这个可见性，的问题。这实际上本质是因为 namespace 做的不够完善。
是的，
这是第一个。第二个就是说，其实除了像这个 C group namespace 这些专门为容器而引入的内核特性之外，其实其他的一些传统的一些内核里面其他的一些部分，也存在着对内核的这种对这个容器支持不好的地方。
是的，肯定是的。
这个东西就是说，有没有考虑过就是把这个 Punch 这样一些对内核的一些改进啊，贡献到这个不仅仅是就是贡献到这个 Linux 的这样一个大的一个社区里面，做一个能够给其他人分享的专门用来对容器支持的更好的，不管是 Docker 也好 Excel 支持的更好的这么一个内核系统啊。
OK， 那我觉得这个问题真的是一下子基本上就扣住了这样的一个今天我分享的主题了啊。那这个方面我可以分享一下阿里在这方面的一些策略。首先第一点，阿里肯定会把这些对内核的改善呢往 Linux kernel 里面去贡献，但是这需要一个周期，我们很难做到把这些 kernel 的一些特性 backport 到之前的那些内核当中去，我们已经很难做到，所以我们只能真正的对于最新的一些代码来做贡献。所以如果我们贡献进去了之后，真正让我们的用户能感受到这些改进改良，也需要有一个很长的周期，这是肯定的吧。那还有一点呢，那我们阿里巴巴其实也开源了阿里 kernel， 我们争取把这部分的东西和社区进行交流。那所以从这个两个方面，阿里其实是对这个社会做了这两个事情。 OK
OK， 谢谢。还有吗？我们因为时间关系还有两个提问机会。
你好，我这边很关注一个容器网络，因为这个 Punch 这边我看到
后期的话会在这个基础设施这边会对接这个 Kubernetes 的这个 CNR， 对吧？就是说后期的话就是 Punch 这边开源会推荐就是什么样的一个容器网络，还是阿里这边会做这个 CNR 的插件之类的？
首先这个方面插件我们是一个首选，
插件是首选是吧？
对，因为网络在标准化这个方面啊，我们会认为容器世界和标准化的网络方面其实还会存在很多的模糊地带。那包括像阿里内部它其实也有自己的一些网络解决方案和容器技术来集成。
那我有一个问题，就是现在的话现网里面这么大规模的这个容器场景哈，现在阿里采用的是什么样的这个容器网络？
OK， 那这个方面的话都是阿里自研的一些网络的解决方案。因为你会发现啊，阿里容器技术其实使用的比较早嘛，它支撑的一些规模和我们现在社区里面的一些网络方案也有差异，所以这个方面全是阿里自研的一套网络的解决方案。
我再补充问一下，就是能大概说一下是基于三层的网络还是 Overlay 的网络吗？
这个方面的话更多的由我们网络的同事我们来交流、
okay.
或者我们台下我们可以更多的交流。好，谢谢啊。
OK， 我们最后一个问题，然后接下来就是还想交流的话我们可以私下找洪亮来交流。
OK，
好，谢谢您的分享。就是我想问一下，刚才说的是100%已经容器化了，是包括数据库这种也都容器了吗？那个100%是什么含义？
OK 这个方面其实是就是数据库是已经容器化的。这个方面的100%呢，其实大家可能会去揣测这个100%后面的这个定语是什么啊？那类型这个方面，我们其实是已经做到100%的容器化了。但是，就像我们所说的，不是说所有的 application、所有的 software 都在容器里面，这个大家肯定是可以理解的。很多的硬件的一些硬件跑在硬件里面的一些software， 其实我们对它进行容器化的话其实价值不是很大。另外一个方面的话，数据库的容器化呢其实也要分场景而言。那你比如说我们需要做到很快的测试部署我们的数据库，那我们觉得容器绝对是一个最好的选择。但是你要考虑到你这堆数据怎么去维护，怎么去管理，怎么去对接你原有的运维工具，那也许容器是你的 Plan B， 是吧？所以会是这样的一个情况。OK， 好，那谢谢大家。好，谢谢大家。
谢谢洪亮的分享。